All the time. That's right. Oh, we're going to have a good time today, I can tell. So, long time ago, Sir Isaac Newton supposedly discovered gravity. You heard this before? Who knows what hit him in the head? Apple. Not a turnip. An apple. Supposedly, Sir Isaac Newton discovers gravity because he's sitting there and an apple hits him in the head, and all of a sudden he had no idea that there was such a thing as gravity because he didn't understand that he ever fell. I don't know how you discover gravity. Doesn't everyone just know that? But I don't know. Anyways, he's credited with discovering gravity. Now, however, Galileo was the one who honestly almost 100 years prior, and I don't know why he's not credited with discovering gravity or someone prior to him, he discovered that things accelerate at the exact same rate. Do you guys remember this? He went up onto the Leaning Tower of Pisa, all right? And I think it wasn't quite leaning as much at that time, but he took two different objects of different size. We'll use a plate. He went up in the tower, really high, and he said, now, who knows what happens if I drop two things, this one being heavier with more mass, and I drop this at the same time, what's going to happen? They fell at the same rate. They fell at the same rate, right? Both plates, no matter what size, they fall at the same rate of acceleration. Small and large objects both fall at the exact same rate. I've been thinking, I think there's a lot to learn from natural science. There's a lot to learn from just observing the world. And we need to pay attention. We need to pay attention to all the things that God has given us. Just go outside and just pay attention to the law of gravity. And think about the law of gravity. Just think about this stuff. And there's power in it. And that God speaks to us through all of his creation. Through every single thing. We observe when we drop the plates. What did you observe? They broke. That's good. That's the number one observation. They broke. Things that fall break. This is actually, that is very, very smart. It's very good paying attention. When things fall, they break. You know, maybe some of our senior brothers and sisters know. If you fall, what happens? You break. Amen? Right? But what else did we notice? We noticed that they fell at the same time, at the same rate of acceleration. They fell at the same speed. We need to pay attention to this. All things fall. All things fall at the same rate. And when we fall, we break. We need to hear this. James 2:10 says this too. Natural science shows us what the Bible says about the law of God. When we talk about sin, sometimes we talk about big sins and little sins like this one. This is just a little white lie, right? Not nearly as good as that big plate up there. That big plate, that was a big sin. That was, you know, that's the kind of sin that, you know, so-and-so sitting on that side, they do that kind of sin. This is my little sin. But that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says all sin is equal. Now, actually, we say that. Christians say that. We say all sin is equal. And that's not quite true. You read through the Bible, you find out that some sins have a greater effect on your life than others. Absolutely. However, all sin breaks the law of God the same. Does it matter what size sin it was when it hits the ground? They both broke, didn't they? Both of them broken. Broken plates. Doesn't matter if it's little. Doesn't matter if it's big. If it hits the ground, it's broke. It's exactly what James 2:10 says. James 2:10 says, "For whoever keeps the whole law yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking it all." Amen? Amen? Amen, sister? It doesn't matter. Little sin, big sin, they break. They break together. All sins break equally. And we have been falling for a long time. Haven't we? We have been falling for a long time, and the farther we fall faster. In fact, the rate is, does anyone know? I don't know if you hear anyone's assigned. What is it? That's exactly right. Things fall at the rate of 9.7, some, almost 8, 9.7 meters per second per second. So that's the rate that it's falling initially. However, after 1 second, it's twice that. And after 3 seconds, it's three times that. It's per second per second. So the farther it falls, the faster it goes. And let's be honest, we've been falling for a long time, haven't we? And at 9.7 seconds, meters per second, things are getting worse. People look around and they study the world and they say, what's wrong with our world? The volcanoes are exploding. The ice caps are melting. The oceans are rising. They say, you know, there are animals that are going extinct. We know, you know, we're worried about global warming, but we all know, scientists all agree, we are all circling a bright hot sun that will one day explode. You weren't worried about global warming. It's going to get hot. let's get real honest. The universe is in a state of falling. It is falling. It's called entropy. It's decay. It's the second law of thermodynamics. It's that everything is falling. Things don't get better. They get worse. Recycle all you want. And you may, you know, hold off some, you know, there may be some global warming that you can stay off, but at some point this world is toast. We're just trying to hold it off by a couple thousand years. We are in a state of falling. This is natural law. This is understood. The world is in a state of free fall. And the Bible says, if you have your Bibles, look with me in Romans. We're supposed to be in 1 Kings this week. And I'm going to bounce a lot around a little bit. 1 Kings is going to be more of the illustration. I'm going to give you two scriptures from Romans. Romans chapter 8, if you have your Bibles. While you're turning there, I'll just remind people, we're going through the Bible. We have a few over there. It's called The Story. It's an abridged Bible. We're going through the whole Bible this year in 38 weeks. And we're in chapter 14. It's an abridged Bible, abridged chronological Bible. We do a chapter a week. If you want to buy one, they're 10 bucks. Stay with us. Next week's chapter 15. It's good stuff. This week, we're looking at the decay of Israel. And as I studied that, it really just made me think about the rest of the world. It made me ask this question, why does everything fall apart? Why is this law of entropy? Why is there a law of falling? Why is there a law of decay? Romans chapter 8 has the answer. Romans chapter 8, I can't read the, I have eye problems. Sorry. Verse 20. I'm looking under my glasses at 3 inches to read that. Verse 20 says, for creation was subjected to frustration. For creation, the world, the universe, for creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it, in hope that the creation itself would be liberated from its bondage to decay, brought into the freedom and glory by the children of God. The salvation of the world actually comes through us, brothers and sisters. The salvation of the world does come. It's not through recycling, but it is through us following Jesus. That's a whole other message. Verse 22. For we know that the whole creation, the whole universe has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. It's all decaying. It's all hurting. It's true. This is all true. Absolutely. The earth is falling apart. Just like you and me, brother. Some of us had birthdays this week. Getting older, aren't we? Day by day, falling apart. We're in a state of entropy. We're in a state of decay. Why? So why? Why is the world in this state? Why am I in this state? Well, if you skip back just a few chapters to Romans chapter 5, there's everything in Romans. Romans is such a beautiful, beautiful book. I'm going to reference it a lot this morning. Romans chapter 5, verse 12. Romans chapter 5, verse 12 says, therefore, just as sin came into this world through one man, and death through sin. So death spread to all men because all sin. Why are we in this state of decay? Why is even the earth itself cursed? Why is everything falling apart? The Bible says so very clearly. Go back to Genesis chapter 3. Because we don't listen to God, the creator of the universe, who set up the laws. We do everything we can to rebel against them. Go ahead and repeat it. Right? Even the computer's like, what? What did he just say? Let me say it again. All right? Sin is the reason that everything is falling apart. That's Romans 5:12. That's entropy. That's acceleration. That's why today, even with all of our modern technology and all of our sophistication, there's more slavery in the world than ever before. We are getting rid of children at a rate never before seen in the world. There's more disease today than ever seen in the world. There is more sin. There are adults who say that when they go to the grocery store, that they're adulting. What does that mean? It's ridiculous. They're adulting. They don't want to adult today. I don't know if you see people who say this sort of thing. I can't adult today. What do you mean you can't adult? Just go to work, you know, whatever. Anyways, I'm sorry. It's sin. Why are we in such a low state? It's sin. It's sin. The falling effect, the process that starts from just the initial state of small significance, it builds on itself. It becomes more grave, more serious, perhaps potentially dangerous, destructive. It is a spiral of decline. We fall faster and faster and faster until we break. Faster and faster and faster until we hit something and we shatter. Israel falls. We've studied this for the last several weeks. We looked at Solomon. We looked at David. We looked at Saul. And we saw that David, a man after God's own heart, this good, godly man, and in the end, God gives him the judgment and says he was a good king. And yet this good king, maybe the best of all Israel's kings, still sins in adultery and in murder. And his son would then introduce idol worship to the nation of Israel. And then his son, whom we read about this week, Rehoboam. Rehoboam would divide the kingdom in half because he was selfish and prideful. If I can, I'll just remind you of what we were supposed to read this week. 1 Kings chapter 12, verse 1 said that all of Israel came to Shechem, and they all came and they wanted to make him the king. But they came and they said, Solomon's taxes are so high. They're so high. Will you just lower taxes? Anyone else feeling that? Lower taxes, amen. That was their one thing. They said, we want to make you the king, but will you lower taxes a little bit? Solomon had raised taxes very high. And so he took, there's a whole sermon here that we covered on Wednesday. And he took a survey. He went to the young men and he went to the old men and he said, young men, what should we do? Old men, what should we do? The older men said, you should lower taxes. Amen. They should lower taxes and the people will love you. The young men said, you know what? You should be twice the king that Solomon was. Raise taxes. And his response is just, it's ridiculous. I'll read it for you. Verse 13 and 14, the king then goes to the people. He answers the people harshly, forsaking the counsel of the old men. We got to pay attention to who we get counsel from. Amen? Who do you listen to? He listens to the young men. He doesn't listen to the old. And isn't that many of our inclinations? We listen to the young men. Why? Because they're better looking? Because they're faster? They're also stupider. We know. We were young. Amen? I'm not condemning them. I'm just saying I was young. I get it. And I may only be a little bit smarter, but I'm a little bit smarter than when I was 20. So he listens to the older men and the counsel that had. He rejects the counsel of the older men. And he spoke to them according to the counsel of the young men, saying, "My father made your yoke heavy. I will add to your yoke. My father disciplined you with whips. I will discipline you with scorpions." That's ridiculous, right? Guess what happens? The people leave. The nation of Israel is forever divided into a northern and to a southern kingdom. And most of Israel leaves. They're gone. And only one tribe truly stays. Judah, some of Benjamin, stay. And truthfully, it's probably more geography than anything else, because they were right there by the king, and if they rebelled, they'd have to actually leave their homes. So they divides the kingdom. The kingdom falls. The kingdom breaks. And like I said, God would then give a word concerning each king. Each king would at some point be given a judgment, and that king would be either called righteous or unrighteous. And Rehoboam is called unrighteous. In 2 Chronicles 12:4, it says, "And he did evil, and he did not set his heart to seek the Lord." Every king of this divided kingdom. The northern tribes, there would be 20 kings. 20 kings of Israel. And none of them are called good by God. None of them. Of the southern kingdom of Judah, there would be 20 kings, of which six did right. Asa, Jehoshaphat, Uzziah, Jotham, Hezekiah, Josiah. David, of the whole history of Israel, makes seven. Seven good kings of 43. That's less than 15%. That's a terrible, terrible ratio, amen, of bad kings. And it reminds me immediately of what Jesus said. Jesus said, "Enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide. The way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few." There are few good kings, amen? There are few good rulers. Let's be real honest. The ladies have been saying it for a long time. There are just not very many good guys. And the guys have been saying the opposite. There's just not that many good girls. There's not that many good people. There are not that many good people that want to follow the Lord. The nation of Israel is falling apart. People are falling out apart. Why? Because of a cancer called sin. And once it begins, it goes faster and faster and faster until it breaks. You've participated in this. You have. Think about it. Think about that lie you told that one time as a brag. Little brag, not a big deal, right? Told a little story, a little embellishment, right? You told that little lie. Then someone called you on part of that, said, well, what about the lie? And then you come up with another lie real quick to say, well, that's what I meant, and that's how that actually happened. And so then you had two lies. Then someone else asked you a question. Then you had to come up with a whole network for that day to explain the whole thing. So you had a whole series of lies that then you told a group of people. So at this point, you have a whole history of lies that you have to hold up. And you are. You're holding it up. Because it's not that hard to lie. And it's not that hard to lie again. And then to hold up your whole story. But now, you are lying to everyone all the time, and including yourself. I have to tell myself this story enough to truly believe it so that I can keep it up. As we fall, it goes faster and faster and faster. And then you become a politician. Right? Isn't that how it works? That's the next step. Once you just use the line all the time, you run for politics. That's how it goes. You do it once, and it doesn't have to be a lie. It doesn't have to be a lie, and you know that. Whatever sin you're talking about, whether it's looking at things or going places that you shouldn't, maybe it's talking about other people, maybe it's an addictive substance. You do it once, and then you do it again, and then you do it again, and then you do it again, and again. Faster and faster and faster and faster. And my question for us today is so simple. How do we stop the falling? How do we stop this falling effect that we are all in since the creation of the world, since the beginning of your life? How do we stop the falling? How do I stop this cycle of sin? What sin has a grip on you, brother? What sin has a grip on you, sister, that you just can't seem to shake? You go back to it over and over and over again. What is it for you? I want to show you a short video that speaks to this, and I believe it gives us the answer in a beautiful way. Each of us are falling, but there's a way out of the cycle.
You. Look at your eyes. Look at them. Speckled. Colorful. Each one unique. And I created every one of them. I created everything. The universe. And you. I gave you your personality. I made you pure. Complex. And every day, I give you life. I love you. But something happened. You cheated on me. You didn't trust me. You sinned. You cut yourself off from me. And although you're still alive, you were slowly dying. So you looked for other things. To fill the void. But nothing works. It just kills you faster. And it separates us more and more. What are you searching for? I don't want you to die. I created you, not to be destroyed, but to know me. So I became one of you, a fragile creation. I was tempted, but I never sinned. I came to save you. You have so many sins, and they have a cost. Someone has to die. You or me. So I took on your sin and traded in my life for yours. And I died in your place. Because I love you. The way, the truth, and here to condemn you. I came to bring you back to life. Rely on me. I will forgive you and give you eternal life. I love you. And I did all of this to have a relationship with you. Will you follow me?
There's a way. There's a way to stop the falling effect on your life. It's through Jesus Christ. He's the Creator. He made you. He has the instruction manual. He has the blueprint for your soul and for your happiness and for your joy. He has it. He knows it. He created you. You want to know why the kings were all bad? Even the good kings, when you really study them, you go, they're not that good. Why is it that all the kings were bad? Because we're all bad. That's what the Bible says. The Bible's very clear. Romans chapter 3, verse 23, says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Pastor Tim has sinned. Pastor Tim has lied. He has stolen. He has made terrible decisions. He's hurt people. I've done it. We're all bad. We've all messed up our lives. We've all broken our lives. We've all been in pain. We've all hurt other people. But see, the problem is with all those bad kings, they were all bad. And the truth is, Israel was never supposed to have a king. If you go back, and we don't have time this morning. Remember in 1 Samuel chapter 8, we studied it several, almost 2 months ago now. The people said, we want a king, we want a king, we want to be just like everyone else. And God said, they're rejecting me. You're not supposed to have a king. Because God's supposed to be your king. The problem is we fall and we cause all this pain and all this hurt in our lives because we're not listening to God. Because we want to be our own little kings and our own little queens in charge of our lives. And guess what? You make terrible decisions. And so do I. We need God. We need Him to help us. Do you want to stop the falling effect in your life? Do you fall? Do you feel like one of those plates? I love this video. It's beautiful, and you can find it online. It's had like 10 million views. You can share it with your friends. It's a beautiful, beautiful thing to share. It's wonderful. But I love it because it's just such a good visual. As you see those plates falling, you go, I feel just like that. I'm falling and I'm flipping and I'm turning and I know that the ground is coming. I know it's coming. Do you want to stop the falling? Do you want to stop the falling? The answer is so simple, my friends, my brothers and my sisters, my friends. Repent of your sin. Repent of your sin and follow God. It is that simple. Make Jesus the king. Make Jesus the Lord of your life. That's what Romans chapter 10, verse 9 tells us to do. And I reference this scripture all the time because it's one of my favorite scriptures. Romans 10, 9 says, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and that means that Jesus is king. And I say, you know what? I don't want my own king. I want Him to be my king. And I want Him to make the decisions because I mess this stuff up. And every decision I make seems like I'm just pushing myself off the edge toward the cliff. And I know I'm going faster and faster. I'm just going to make You the Lord of my life. Will You please make the decisions for me? I'll let You control it. You can do it better than I can. I know You can. You're the boss if you confess Him as Lord. And if you believe in your heart that God rose Him from the dead, that means you believe in the work of Jesus Christ. You believe in His birth. You believe in His death on a cross for your sins. And you believe in His resurrection, not just paying the price I love that part in the video, right? The plate falls, sits on the ground. And he says, but then, oh, there's more. I didn't just pay the price for your sin. There's more. And I'm telling you, I've watched this video 1,000 times. And I cry. I cry. I've cried so many times. It's ridiculous. They're plates. They're plates. But the plates start going up. They come back together. And they go up. And the tree, the burns all leave it. And all this, it's just beautiful. The cup is turned upright. It's just this beautiful picture. It can be turned. It can be reversed. The falling effect is reversed through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He can change the direction of your life, not just on this earth, but for all eternity. We can be put back together, and we can ascend to heaven to live with Him forever. Oh, oh, it's beautiful. It's beautiful. My question, do you want to stop the falling? Do you want to stop the falling? You want to stop the falling? Start following Jesus and make Him your King today, right now. Because you're not guaranteed tomorrow. You're not guaranteed lunch. The end could be like that. And do you want your life to shatter? Or do you want your life to be remade? If you want to reverse the falling effect in your life, the falling effect of sin in your life, I want to encourage you today to make a decision to make Him the Lord of your life. Just through a prayer. Just through a prayer. You have to mean it, of course. You can't just say stuff. It has to be from here. Confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe. It has to be real. I want to give you the opportunity. Christian, maybe for you, you're just recognized, I haven't been. And even, you know what, the truth is even us brothers and sisters, we fall. We may not break, but we fall. Brothers and sisters, do you need to repent of sin? Do you need to say, you know what, I need to make you the King because I keep getting my little crown out, putting it on my head. I need to give it back to you again. I want to give you that opportunity right now to do business with God. Just let's bow our heads right now so that each of us can just kind of be in a moment alone. Just everyone with eyes closed. This is just you and God. Just you and God right now.